Amen. Glory to God. Whoa. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I just want to give you a greeting this evening from the Holy Spirit. Amen. I want to give you a greeting from the folks here at Acts Mission in Galena and in Port Maria, a beautiful parish here on the island of Jamaica. And those of you, wherever you are, that will view this today or later, you know, I just want to say we appreciate you. Before I get in to, I want to just make a couple of announcements before I move on a little bit further. We have to, we are praying for our dear sister Dazlin Downer. She lost her brother, I believe, today, and he's here in Jamaica, and you know, we are praying God's grace on her and her family. Also, we have a guest on tonight that has been trying to get on. Can you do me a favor, just flip on the fan? Okay, we have a guest on tonight with us that has been trying to get on for quite a while, but has just been successful this evening, and we see her on. Sister Nora Strudwick, we really, Sister Nora, good to have you on. I think I met her one-on-one in Kingston. That lady just so sweet when you speak with her on the phone and, you know, and on WhatsApp and so on. Wonderful young lady. We just so appreciate people like that. But tonight I want to talk for about 10 minutes about an issue that just occurred in Jamaica. This morning, one of my former members from our church in Kingston called me. I had started a church in Kingston many years ago. And after starting the church in Kingston, we ran into some serious challenges. The Lord showed me the enemy was not really pleased with some of the things we were doing. And he showed me three, in a vision, he showed me three powers, three entities, let's put it that way, that would come against me, and they were coming out of the sea. And so they came up on the shore and they were heading right towards where I was. And eventually we saw the enemy come in and we saw the attack and we, you know, had the experiences we had. We thank God that we are still around, amen, and we can still laugh. We can still enjoy, you know, the presence of God. But it was a challenge. The reason why I'm sharing that is recently, on Sunday morning at 10:30, it's about almost 10:30 a.m., in a church in Trelawney, a parish here on the northern coast of Jamaica, a lady, a 51-year-old lady, I think, was in church in prayer and praise and worship. And while she was sitting there, a young man walked in, sat behind her, and within a few minutes, apparently, shot her. Fatally shot her. People are wondering, where is God? What's going on? Where is God? I want you to remember something. I said it when I first started this series of teachings. There's a reason why the Lord has me do things. And this season of teachings on the Holy Spirit is significant to the body of Christ. Because a lot of us, if not most of us, we are walking around, you know, as human beings, yes, but we have no true sense of what our Christian virtues, our Christian abilities, and our Christian authority is. And so we allow anything to happen. There's a picture this morning, for example, that I saw posted, and it had the, if you're on my Facebook page, you'll have seen it. I put it up. It's a picture of Noah's Ark. And when you saw Noah's Ark, the person says something about faith. Is faith telling the storm to stop or something like that, or telling God to stop or calm the storm? And they said, no, it's telling God to help you through the storm. That's a lie. Noah is the only one that went through that kind of storm. You and I, based on what the Lord has said, based on what the scripture has shown us, you and I, we speak to our storm like Jesus spoke to the storm in the book of Mark and in the book of Matthew. Okay, we don't entertain storm. We don't ride out the storm in the boat. We don't ride out the storm. We speak to the storm and we walk in the sense of God's peace. And the storm has to be obedient to what we say. Now, this lady is sitting in church, and the person comes up behind her, shoots his weapon, and kills her. I mean, come on now. Do you realize what's going on? Let me just give you the scene. The praise and worship leaders are on the platform. The minister is on one side of the platform. The church members are sitting around in the sanctuary, and all you hear, and you can find it on YouTube, all you hear is blam, 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 and then everybody starts to scream. One lady on the platform begins to scream, Jesus. But the question that comes up now for many people, where was God? Where was God? Is God dead? Where on earth was God in that situation? And we know we have many things that we can say. We can say the woman did something wrong and so she deserved it. We can say, I mean, any number of things. We can say it was her time to go. You know, we can say God needed another angel in heaven and so he took her. We have any number of explanations in our natural minds that we can use. But I want to share this. In the book of Ezekiel, in the 8th chapter, at the very end of the chapter, it says the reason why violence is in the land is because the church is not what the church ought to be. It says that violence has overtaken the land because the believers, it calls them the people of Judah, we are not doing and we're not being all we need to be. When I first came to Jamaica, one of the powerful things that we brought was the understanding of the move of the Holy Spirit in the body of Christ, especially these 9 gifts. Many times, and I shared some examples with you, many times what happened to me from the day I got on the island of Jamaica, and even before, but primarily, this really kicked off in me when I was watching Benny Hinn and I was watching Richard Roberts in Tulsa, Oklahoma, over several months. But I remember one day, the Spirit of God said to me, and he mentioned 3 ministers. He says, I want you to sow into these ministries. And so I sat down and I sowed a certain amount of money. I wrote 3 checks and I sent it to these ministries. And he said, the reason why I've asked you to do that is because when you sow into those ministries, the anointing or the abilities in the kingdom that they walk in will begin to manifest in you and upon you and in your ministry. And lo and behold, the very night I sent the first check, I was at a Bible study, and won't get into detail, but I mean, some tremendous things happened that I'd seen happen in one of the same men's ministry that never happened to me before. So obviously it was not serendipity. It was not accidental that the Lord said that, and then obedience caused me to begin to walk in that. So when I came to Jamaica, I began to share with the people, there is a magnificence in the presence and power of the Holy Spirit. He opens your eyes to things that you have no true natural ability to understand. He shows you your tomorrow from today. He shows you what's going on around you behind the scenes. He shows you the why behind the what. He gives you the ability to create an atmosphere of miracles. He allows you to speak into your world. He allows you to walk in prophecy, to exhort, to edify, and to comfort. He allows you to move in such a tremendous ability that only he can. What I've noticed, and I thank God for each one of you that's with me and has been with me for the last few weeks, because people reject the message. And there is a scripture in the Bible. It says, my people are destroyed for a lack of knowledge. People die, like this woman, because of a lack of knowledge. People have sickness and disease many times. You and I'm not excluding myself, because of a lack of knowledge. And it says 3 things in that verse. It says, we lack knowledge. That is, we don't have what we need to have. And sometimes we don't know we need it until someone comes. When we are receptive enough, someone comes and shares it. And so when they share it and we receive it, we are empowered. The second thing in that verse, when it says that we are destroyed for a lack of knowledge, but then it says also because we have rejected knowledge. So someone comes and tells us about the Spirit of God. There's a church in Port Maria that I went into, and I was sharing about the Holy Spirit and the power of the Spirit. And the gentleman who was an elder in the church came to the friends of mine who were elders in that organization and told them that they should never have me back in the church. Now, he doesn't know that I know he said that, because the elders never said that to me, but I saw him and I heard him. I saw the conversation and I heard the conversation in the spirit. And I remember, because now whenever I meet him, whenever I get around him after that, he could never look me in the eye again. And I could look him in the eye and I could greet him, you know, as a brother in Christ, but that was his attitude. In that ministry, one of those very same elders over the last couple of years has lost so many relatives to cancer. I mean, just one after the other, after the other, after the other. Because I dearly and unfortunate, I mean, it burns me, it hurts my heart, that one man can have such a negative influence that he can cause a church to miss it. He can cause a people to miss it. He can cause people to die because he has rejected the word of God. He has rejected the revelation of the Spirit of God. The third thing, as I said, we start out with what? A lack of knowledge. We then move into rejecting knowledge. The third thing in that verse is that we have forgotten what the law of God said. And so over the years, we have been Christians forever. So in our 50th year of Christianity, we forgot the blessings, and we forgot the grace, and we forgot the tenacity, and we forgot the zeal. You know, early on, some people may have zeal without knowledge, but over the years, we have developed knowledge and we have developed zeal based on the foundation of knowledge. But then what has happened is that because of the erosion of the world and the challenges of life, some things leak out.
But we have to remind ourselves of the goodness of God. We have to remind ourselves of the grace of God. We have to remind ourselves of the wonderful nature of God that is available to us. And it tires me. I'm going to be very blunt with what I'm about to share. But it really tires me and challenges me significantly when I see a church. God is not dead, but the church is dead. I'm going to tell you right up front. The majority of people, we get together in prayer meetings. We have national prayer conferences. What I've noticed is that the Prime Minister, for example, the Prime Minister of Jamaica, made a request at a recent prayer conference or prayer breakfast, and he requested that the church get more involved in the communities and in helping communities to resolve the issues of violence and so on and things going on. And it was notable that the leaders of the evangelical churches in Jamaica, the leader of the larger organizations of churches in Jamaica, began to talk about the social programs that they wanted to implement and how they needed to do this and do that. So what they are talking about is taking the world plan and bringing it into the church. Jesus Christ didn't implement a social program to deal with the issues that were occurring in Jerusalem. He preached, he taught, he preached, and he healed, signs and wonders following. Philip did the same thing. Peter and Paul and all these men did the same thing. I never saw one of them have a social program, except in the book of Acts, where they said the disciples that were in the church came to eat together. That's the only social program that I have ever really encountered in the scripture. But I will tell you this, in Mark chapter 16, the Bible tells us clearly that we will, as men and women that believe in God, we will heal the sick, we will raise the dead. It says we will be protected. You know, serpents can harm us and things can't come against us in the way that I see things coming against us. We talk about the 91st Psalm. Where was the 91st Psalm? 1,000 shall fall at your side and 10,000 at your right hand, but it shall not come near you. Where was the 91st Psalm when the gun was raised, when it says, or the book of Isaiah, it says, no weapon formed against you shall prosper. Where were these scriptures that morning when the young man raised that weapon behind that woman and pulled the trigger? Where was the scripture that talked about you and I having the ability to see ahead? The word of knowledge, what was in the heart of this man. Now, I want you to hear this. Many years ago, I remember the man, a minister, a bishop, that had died, and I was at his funeral in Maypen, in Clarendon. And while I was there, I was asking them what had happened. How did he die? His wife was a nurse and so on. And they said he had an aneurysm or some kind of a bleeding in the frontal area of his brain. And so I said, tell me a little bit about it. Tell me what happened. And they said, well, they had a vision. Somebody had a vision. I think it was his brother, who was also in the church, maybe a deacon or a minister in the church. They had a vision that there was something like an angel that came and speared him right in his forehead. And so I said, so what did you do? And they said, well, we realized, the wife said it and the brother said it, we realized that God was showing us how he was going to die. God was showing us how he was going to die. So as I said, we have a couple of people that just joined us. So as I said, the bishop, his brother and his wife had a vision. And the vision was that an angel or something that appeared like an angel speared him right in the forehead here. And they said, well, you know, God is showing them that he was going to die. And I said to them, why would you think the Lord would do that? Because the Bible tells us that before anything happens, the Spirit of God will warn us. So it was indeed a warning. It was not a premonition. Okay, premonition says this is going to happen. But it was a warning, say, hey, you need to do something about this. Come on, you people, you are intercessors of the Most High God. You have an ability in Christ to deal with things in the world around you. And you hear your brother, and you see your brother in a vision being speared by a principality or a power that does not, young man, does not want him to continue in the ministry, and you just let it go and say, well, God's will be done. It's an incredible thing when we do things like that. We've got to realize that we misunderstand, that we misinterpret the leading of God. It even happens, you know, beyond that. It even happens to us right now where the Lord will share things with us. And as he shares things with us, what we do, you know, we just let it go. We just let it slide. And we don't really go back and look at the scripture that is related to the situation that comes before us. We use what our denomination may have said, what my brother has said, maybe what I've learned. You know, I've been in seminary and all of that, so maybe what I've learned in seminary I use. I've been in seminary, and there are some things in seminary I will not talk about in the pulpit, because there were some things that were very misguided based on the scripture and based on revelation from the New Testament church. And so we then need to truly understand what it is that God is saying. What is he saying to you about the situation that confronts you? You know, what is he saying to you about this woman that died? You know, and so many are. By the way, this is not the first shooting in a church here. A pastor several years ago, not too many years ago, a pastor, I think he was getting ready to teach Bible study or something like that in a church. He might have been over in Spanish Town area or something. He was getting ready to do his thing. And a gunman walked in and just shot him, killed him right there in the pulpit. Again, where is the 91st Psalm? Remember, the 91st Psalm says, it says, no arrow.
No weapon. Okay.
No weapon has the ability to destroy you. So what are we believing as children of God? Are we just walking around benignly accepting all these things? I think the church is afraid. A very good friend of mine, a few days ago, I was at his business place. I do consulting from time to time. I'm an IT person, and so I developed a system for them. And so I was there, and he's probably in his late 60s. He asked me a question, and then he said he was talking to a pastor, his wife's pastor, and he said, he asked his wife's pastor, in your church, which apparently is a pretty large church, he asked his wife's pastor, how many people do you think in this church, how many people do you think are committed? How many people do you think are committed? And he said, the pastor answered, he can't answer that question. That's a sad commentary. If we don't know the level of commitment in the church, because I can tell you whether or not people are committed, and I can tell you which ones, based on my observation and the fruit of their lives, which ones are committed. But I want to tell you something about you. I see Patricia, I see Joy with her fire tablet, and I see Scott and Olivine and Dazzling and Erica and Alcatel and Nora and Sister Monica. And I don't know who U693CLE is, and Hazel is there. Kenny is there. One or two other people came in, but they left. But this is the kind of thing I'm talking about. When they come in and they hear things like this, they're not willing to listen. They're absolutely not willing to listen because it challenges them. The Holy Spirit is not dead. He is alive. The Holy Spirit wants to work through the believer. But we sit around and we sing nice songs and we titillate our emotions. You know, oh, we shout hallelujah and we get in tongues and we fall on the ground and we roll and we do so many things. And then we are still, when we get into the world, we are still extremely powerless to do anything to affect or affect the situation of life around us. Amen. And if we don't take time, there's somebody that's coming in. Yeah, if we don't take time to understand the Christ that's in us. Now, we'll make mistakes. One day, I was praying at my church in Kingston. And this is what I'm telling you. God tells us ahead of time. He prepares us. Many times he has said to me, tell this person that danger is around the corner. Tell this person, don't go here. Just a few weeks ago, I can tell you this. Just a few weeks ago, somebody, I can't tell you all the details because of the privacy issue, but somebody calls me up and says, Pastor, a gunman came to kill my husband. Right here in Jamaica, somebody I know personally, and we were talking about it, and the person says, Pastor, we need to pray because somebody sent a gunman to assassinate my husband. It just so happened that I was praying. And it's funny, about 12 years before that, I gave her a word. 12 years before that, I gave her a word in our church. And she said, a few days before this gunman showed up, she was flipping through her Bible. I don't know, you ladies out there, man, you keep everything. I don't know. 12 years ago, I don't know if I would have that still. But you ladies keep everything. Well, she flips through the Bible and she reads about Esther and Haman and how the enemy was going to come up against, you know, Mordecai and the Jews. And she said the Lord told her to go on a fast. And when she goes on the fast, this happens. It so happens that her husband, that morning, he was led. And she was led to not go into the premises. You see what I'm saying? God knows. God prepares us. And then she said, we need to pray. And so, you know, I prayed with her and covered her with the blood of the Lamb. And they came back and actually they went and they encountered the man that sent the gun with the security, with the JC of the Jamaica Constabulary Force. They went and they said to him, we know this, this is this, and this is that. And they said, you are lucky that they don't want to prosecute you right now. You understand me? So God does not leave us without a witness. Come on. You are the church. You are the church. You have the Spirit of God. You have the unlimited power of God on the inside of you. You have the ability to see into your tomorrow when you pray in the Holy Ghost. You have the ability, just today, well, we were in the back, Sean, Lisa, Minister Blackford, myself, and one or two other people. And so Minister Blackford turns to me and Minister Blackford says, Rev, or it might have been Sean, but Sean said, Rev, Blackford is thinking this and this and this and this and this. So when I listened to what they were saying, it was a word of knowledge from God. I've been talking about the word of knowledge. It's a word of knowledge. It says, if you do this, you'll save tens of thousands of dollars. And so I said, my God, that's a word from God. Hey, woo! You want to tell me that God can't do things like that? If God can do that, you know, I've been places, and let me just end with this part of it. I've been places where as I step into the place, or before I step into, while I'm praying, before I get there, God shows me what I'm going to meet. I've been places when I step in there, the Lord says, step out. I've been places where he tells me, danger, but I will protect you. I remember when I drove into August Town in Kingston,
And I was out there on the street corner and people said gunshots are firing and police is out there. And the police actually drove up to the corner that I was standing on and I was preaching the night. And when the policemen came and they sat in the car, I think I went over and at one point and we were talking and they said they did not understand what that peace was over August Town that night. They said something was different. And they had to drive around and find out what was going on in August Town. You want to tell me that God is not powerful and we are talking about getting social programs? I'm not saying social programs are bad, but we have lost sight of the power of God. We want to bring a governmental program into the church. We want to educate them in this and educate them in that, but nobody is telling them about the power of the Spirit. I mean, I've been around gunmen right here in Galena that have come and sat at my table. And I remember one of them, several of them were around the table at the time, but one of them began to talk to me and says, you know, Rev, you don't know who I am or whatever. I says, well, maybe I have an idea. And he began to tell me how, you know, and when and why and from Kingston to here and this and that. He began to share some really detailed things with me. And when he shared it afterwards, the following morning, I mean, we made the night, you might have been there. The night when we had the curry chicken and we had a small pot of curry chicken, Brother Teddy, a small pot of curry chicken. And let me tell you something, that curry chicken, it served like what? About 15 people that night. And we didn't know how it expanded like that, amen. But God provided. The next morning, I was coming out in the community and somebody said to me, Pastor, do you know who you had in your house last night? I mean, he says, you had some thieves in your house and you have some gunmen in your house and you have this in your house last night. I said, yes, I know. Actually, they told me who they were, but they gravitated toward me. Why? Because I was eloquent? No. Because I was from America? No. Because they recognized the power of God that was changing their lives. They still come and sit in front here with me. If anything goes wrong in their lives, I'm the first person they run to and come and sit right in the front out there. One of them, one day I was sitting in a wheelbarrow and he was sitting on a cinder block outside and we were out there just talking about life. And he said, it was like the same one, he said he was in Kingston after we had first met. He said he was in Kingston and he was sitting there at the edge of a gully in a part of Kingston. I think it was in the White House area. And he said he was sitting there on the edge of the gully, and he says, he picked up the gun and he's looking at the gun, and he says, all of a sudden something comes over him. It's like it's a warmth comes over him and he begins to cry. Tears started to come. He's telling me this. And he says, immediately he remembers me talking with him. And he says, I can't do this at all. And he picks himself up. He said he didn't want the other guys to see him cry. He picked himself up and he came right back home to St. Mary. That's the power of God. It was not a social program. You know what I mean? We weren't doing any great thing like that. We were just speaking the word of God. The church has lost its way in a tremendous way. The church needs to get back. And when I say the church, I'm not talking about the building or the denomination. I'm talking about you and I. Because our leaders are creating wonderful music and beautiful building and wonderful, as I said, programs that they have extracted from the world. But there is no power to change a life. I was in the hills of St. Andrew, where they grow Blue Mountain coffee up in that area. I forget the name of the area. Way up in the hills. And we were there for a whole week having meetings, revival meetings. The meetings did not end earlier than 12:30 a.m.
And I remember one night in particular, I had had an altar call, and a young man came up. I mean, rough look, I mean, big guy, looked kind of like my brother, big strapping fellow. And I remember hitting him in the chest. I didn't even think about it. I just slapped him in the chest and said, "Your mother been praying for you. Your auntie been praying for you. The church been praying for you, and you've been fooling around." Tears just started to come to his eyes, and he gave his life to the Lord. That same night, at 12:30 a.m., when we let out, it's now going on to 1 a.m. I am driving home down the hills. Mavis Bank is the name of it. Mavis Bank. I mean, it's way up in the middle of nowhere. I'm driving down from Mavis Bank in the dark. I mean, pitch black dark. And as I'm coming down, there's a car, two or three cars, but one in particular is coming down behind me fast with lights on and flashing lights. Wah, wah, wah! You know, and trying to catch up with us. So now I'm saying, "Lord, what did we do now?" Well, I pull over and they come down and they came over to me and they said, Pastor, there's a person in this car and a person in that car and the Holy Ghost is so on them, you need to lay hands on them. My God. 1 o'clock in the morning, we are on the hills in Mavis Bank in St. Andrew and God shows up on the hillside. Come on. I go into churches here and they look at me like I'm strange. Because I talk about the Holy Ghost. They look at me like I'm strange because I talk about the healing power of God. I talk about faith in God. I talk about not taking what the enemy is dishing out. They look at me like, "Who do you think you are?" And they reject knowledge. But there's somebody, I don't remember who it is, somebody said to me once, I have said it many times, but they reminded me of it. When the student is ready, the teacher appears. I think it was Cindy Trim that I heard make that statement. When the teacher is ready, when the student is ready, the teacher appears. And God is preparing you for a reason. You're not watching this and going through these teachings just because. Sister Downer is not going through this just because. The joys. They're not going through this, Olives. They're not going through this just because. You are not experiencing the power of God. Just because. Nora, you know, Nora's church in Kingston, one of the larger Methodist churches in Kingston, asked me to come over and teach. Maybe 2 years ago, asked me to come over and teach on the demonic world and its influence. And I was kind of surprised that this mainline denominational church would ask a question like that and for me to come. And I tell you something, when I got around the people, they were like sponges. I mean, they were ready to draw. They were ready to pull. They were just ready to just take everything that God had for them. And that's how Nora got to know about me. And now she is in contact with us. But people have gone. We need to wake up. God is not dead, the church is. And when I say the church is, I'm not talking about the body of Christ. I'm not talking about those that are steadfast yet, awaiting the presence and the return of our Lord Jesus Christ. I'm talking about the ones that are listless, tired, lazy, and good for nothing. I told you I'm not gonna mince my words. I'm not gonna be diplomatic this evening. We are just too darn lazy as Christians. We want to be spoon-fed. We want everything microwaved. I put up 3 scriptures this morning, and I dare say most people probably never read the scriptures. They only read the caption. They would not have taken the time to go in and see what the scripture said. Microwave Christianity. Quick results. We are not ready to push. I've been a Christian now since I was 5 years old. And remember the day the Lord said to me and spoke to me about how long I'd been a Christian. I did not even think about it, never thought about it until he said it. And I recognized that I could be and would be nothing without him. I would be insignificant without him. And the years that he has schooled me and taught me, today, I am really, really, really disappointed in what I see around me. I am not a Superman, I'm not a super anything, but I understand the simplicity of relationship with God. I know that he loves me. I know that he cares for me. I understand how he delivered me. And I know how he keeps me. I know how he has restored me, just like he can do for you and those around you this today and every day. Let's take a moment. And Father, we just thank you for this evening. And we thank you, Lord God. It's a little late. I've talked for too long, but I'm going to take some time and just talk about the word of wisdom, giving a little bit of an insight. But I thank you for the word, Father God, and I thank you for giving us the ability to share among each other. I thank you for the wisdom of heaven that you have put on the inside that we can impart. I thank you that the people, all of them that I see in this list tonight, Lord God, that as they hear the word, Father, it will come alive. It will become a rhema word, a living word, Father, within them. And Father, as they walk in this life, Lord God, they will walk in the ability of God and not in their own strength and in their own ability. They will not walk in the ability of a denomination, the ability of a natural circumstance, but the ability of a supernatural God that is ready to do for them miraculous things. In Jesus' name, amen. I'm going to put the booklet up on the screen. Those of you who haven't gotten it, it's shareable on my, it is shareable on my, Google Drive. It's shareable on my Google Drive, and the link is right there on the page. And the link is in most of the things you'll see in WhatsApp and so on. But we're talking about the nine gifts of the Spirit. And what I'm going to do is just go ahead and talk. I won't even get into the first scripture. We have done that before. We are talking about the three revelation gifts, the word of wisdom and the word of knowledge. Tonight we are talking or introducing the word of wisdom. And so I want us to go down to page 3, I think, which has the word of wisdom. And you'll notice it says, and somebody asked us the other night, in studying the nine gifts of the Spirit, we can see from the scriptures that all of the gifts work according to the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Holy Spirit distributes the gifts. The Holy Spirit allows us as individuals to walk in the gift that's necessary at that time. So Sister Nora may exercise a particular gift at one moment, and then tomorrow she's in a different circumstance and she exercises another gift. But the issue is, as I've said before, is that many of us don't realize we are walking in the gift. The circumstances occur and we do what God says do, but we don't truly have an understanding that this is a gift of the Holy Ghost. He will not use everyone the same way. The Bible plainly says that the Holy Spirit divides his manifestation to every man as he wants, not as we want. So you can want whatever you want, and you can work it out. Let me just warn people that you can work it out, and you can have the manifestation of certain things that look like, but they're not genuine. The Bible plainly states that the Holy Spirit divides the manifestation of the gifts to every man. Someone may want to use a gift a certain way or use a certain gift, but it may not be God's will. And so then you have to be patient and you have to allow God. You ask him. I've asked him, God, I need to understand this gift and then show me. We must stay open to God and let his will be done. Not everyone will have all of the manifestations of the gifts, but we will have individual manifestations. For to one is given by the Spirit the word of wisdom, to another the word of knowledge by the same Spirit. Different giftings, but yet the same Holy Ghost. It is therefore then quite obvious that all the gifts aren't given to everyone. As the body of Christ, let's all desire
God's Holy Spirit to manifest what he wants to manifest when he needs to manifest it through us. And let us be obedient. And let's always look at these things from a scriptural perspective and not an opinion. Some of our wrong thinking keeps us from the best that God has for us. So let's stay in the Word of God. Let's take a look now at the Word of Wisdom. We have a few minutes. We have about 14, 15 minutes before we have our question and answer. The gift of the Word of Wisdom. Regarding the scripture, to one is given by the Spirit the word of wisdom, to another the word of knowledge by the same Spirit. And then we see that it's in 1 Corinthians 12:8. I think you're going to look at this and you're going to realize some things that have been occurring in your life, and it's going to open your eyes to some issues. We must call spiritual gifts what the Bible calls them, or we will become confused. For example, if you call, as it says right there, I'm saying, if you call a dog a cat, somebody will look at you and says, you're nuts. So if you're talking about the word of wisdom, it is the word of wisdom, not the gift of wisdom. If it's the word of knowledge, it is not the gift of knowledge. It is a word. It is God giving us an opportunity to get into a part of knowledge in an area of a situation in life that we are faced with at that moment in time. 1 Corinthians 12:8 is not talking about natural wisdom, and it's not talking about natural knowledge. It's talking about what? Supernatural knowledge. It is talking about just what it says, the word of wisdom and the word of knowledge. And these gifts of the word of wisdom and the word of knowledge are given by the supernatural presence of the Holy Spirit that lives within you. They are not natural gifts. God knows everything, but he never reveals everything to any of us, every single thing. It is, for example, when you go to an attorney. I've engaged an attorney in several things. When I go to an attorney and I say, I want to engage you for this matter, he doesn't give me every single set of laws. I have an attorney that, you know, handles some things for me with the IRS. He didn't tell me about every IRS law. He told me about the laws relevant to the particular situation that I went to him with. Well, it's just like God. God gives you whatever is relevant to that moment in time. He gives you a word. He gives you information that will help you, that will allow you to move with understanding and ability. He only reveals a part of his wisdom to man, that which he wants him to know at a given time. The word of wisdom is not just wisdom in the affairs of life. The word of wisdom is confused many times. I want you to look at that statement. The word of wisdom is confused many times with simple wisdom in the affairs of life. There are people that just have, for example, in Jamaica, there are people that work in the market that really have no education. They have no serious degrees. They have probably never been out of high school, but you cannot cheat them with money. They have a natural wisdom. They have an ability to make change and do things that you and I, and even do business. When you look at some of these market, especially the market ladies, you know, when the entrepreneurial attitude and ability they have, they know what to buy, they know how to display it. They know, I was looking at this display one day across the street from the prayer center. This young man has a store. Derek has a store over there. And I'm looking before I met him, because I ended up walking over and asking, how do you know how to do that? I mean, how he displays his merchandise. You know, the color scheme, how he puts one ahead of the other, and how I just an amazing gift to have a good marketing presentation in the front of his little area there. And so there are people that have that kind of an ability, but this is not that kind of ability. I'm talking about a Holy Ghost supernatural ability. It's not just simple wisdom. The word of knowledge is a little bit different from the word of wisdom. I said the word of knowledge is a supernatural revelation by the Spirit of God concerning certain facts in the mind of God. That's the word of knowledge. It's a supernatural revelation by the Spirit of God concerning certain facts. Facts meaning what? It's now. It's happening now. It's going on now. It's a now situation. It's a now word of information in the mind of God. Facts about people, facts about places, facts about things in the past or present. Amen? So this is not future. This is in past or present.
the word of knowledge is giving you an ability to see. It gives you, well, you know, if you have a demonic issue, if you have a problem in your life, this is how it started. And so the word of knowledge gives you an ability to share with people. The word of wisdom is a supernatural revelation by the Spirit of God concerning the divine purpose and plan in the mind and will of God future. It helps you see your tomorrow. It helps you see where you're going. There was a young man that was in seminary with me. I actually didn't meet him when I was in school. I met him in Jamaica. He was from Europe, and he had started, he had been visiting Europe, one of the countries there, and he had been starting churches. And so he said at night while he was in school and studying, he would pray. He would sit and pray in the Holy Ghost. And while he was praying in the Holy Ghost, you know, he would envision where he was. He would envision what he was doing. And he says when he got to Europe, when he went into some of these countries and he went to these places, the very thing, he's like he had a deja vu experience because the word of wisdom was showing him where he was headed. The word of wisdom was giving him an idea of what was going on. I decided to go to France several years ago. And I remember I had a vision of getting out of my body and going to France. And when I got to France, I'm walking around the streets. I had never been to France. I really had not seen pictures of France that I can remember. And I remember walking around the streets and seeing the little carts and seeing the little bistros on the sidewalk. I remember walking around and seeing the little shops and seeing the various little things that you would think would be in, even the metro, you know, would be in Paris. And when I got there, I'm looking around and I am astounded, the things that I saw in the vision. The word of wisdom showing me ahead of time. The word, and I was able to minister to people. The word of wisdom is the best gift because it is a what? A revelation concerning the plans and the purposes in the mind of God. He's telling you where you're heading. He's telling you where your brother is heading, where your sister is heading. He's telling you if there's a gunman out there waiting for you. Come on. Come on. He's telling you if there's an accident down the street waiting for you. He's telling you to wait today. Don't leave so early today. He's telling you, come on. He's telling you, take some time today. Don't go in. How many people at the World Trade Center didn't go into that job that day? The difference between the two gifts, the word of knowledge and the word of wisdom, is that the revelation of the word of knowledge brings, the revelation the word of knowledge brings is always present tense or concerning something that has already happened. On the other hand, the word of wisdom speaks of the future, of the tomorrows. And so there are people that will come to me and they will ask me, or usually they don't ask because I won't, if they ask me, well, usually I'm not going to respond that way. But when the Lord says something, let me give you an example of a word of wisdom. I was invited to a church in, was it Lionel Town? I was invited to a church in Lionel Town twice. The first year I was invited to the church, I got into the pulpit and the Spirit of God, it's like somebody came up to me and started to tell me what was going on in the church. And while I'm standing, the Spirit of God says, there is somebody, a woman in the church that has caused a tremendous conflict and separation. You were there that night. And the Spirit of God says, if you don't repent before the, this is like what, September, October, their convention time. And so the Spirit of God said, if you don't repent, you will have a serious bout with cancer and you will not live into the next year. In January, the pastor calls me and says, Rev, because I didn't follow up, Amy. I'm not concerned. I'm just hearing what God says. The Spirit of God says this, so I share it. The pastor says, Rev, you don't know. He didn't tell me that after the service. I just left it and went home. He says, you don't know what had happened. This lady had caused so much problems for me, and she upset the people in the church, and she upset the church, and she split the church. She just died of cancer. I was at the same church a year later, and a young man was sitting in the back of the church, probably in his 20s.
I don't know who he was. I have no idea who he was. The Spirit of God said, call him up. And the Spirit of God said to him, through me, the Spirit of God said to him through me, says, young man, the Lord says, you've been causing a lot of problems in your household and with your, you know, with your faith. And he's saying some other things, and then he says, if you do not change your attitude and if you do not turn from your wicked ways, you will not live past 2 months. Now, I strongly dislike sharing things like that. But what am I saying? I'm saying God gives us warnings. He's not just jumping us and slaps us upside the head, as people say. He warns us. He gives us the opportunity to adjust our behavior. Several months later, the same pastor calls me up again and he says, Rev, do you remember you sharing a word with a fellow in the church? I said, yeah. What? Because again, I didn't follow up on it because I'm not interested in anybody coming asking me, well, what did God say? What did he mean? Or anything like that. I do not discuss what the Lord says like that. And so the pastor tells me that the young man did not listen to the word of God. And he was in a serious car accident and died. I did not realize that it was the son of a bishop in an organization in the area. But let me tell you what happened. The organization that this bishop was in had invited me to speak to their youth that summer in a summer camp they were having. When his son died, he canceled the meeting. I mean, he just shut everything down. They're afraid of me. They don't want me to go. We are afraid of the Holy Ghost and his correction. Come on. My friends, you have to understand this. The Lord gives us instructions. He corrects us. You think, I've been through a whole lot when it comes to the Holy Spirit with these kinds of things. I've had to deal with people that have rejected me, looked me cross-eyed and cursed me out behind my back. And I know it. And I know it. I can tell you story after story after story after story that people have come back and said, Pastor, when you said that to this person, this is what they said when you left, and this is what happened. Time and time again. Friends, if I can do this, I am not special. God does not bless me with the gifts of the Spirit because I'm Pastor Watson. He does not bless me with the manifestation of the Holy Ghost because I'm Bishop Watson. He blesses me with the manifestation of the Holy Ghost because I'm a child of God. He blesses you with the manifestation of the Holy Spirit because you're a child of God. Open your heart and ask him to begin to show you. I did not share this earlier. The pastor of the church where the woman died was on an interview. I was listening to him. And he said the morning he got to church, you got to understand this. Everybody makes mistakes. I'm not blaming him or anything like that, but I hope we learn. He walks into the church and he turns and he looks and he sees this young man sitting there. And he says something and rubs him the wrong way with this young man. And he felt to go over and say something to him. And he told the interviewer that he did not have the will. He did not have the will. I wonder if he had gone, and this is just speculation, I don't know. But I wonder if he had gone over there, would that young man have just fallen to the ground and said, Jesus? Because the pastor had walked over and said something. Because the moment he walks over, then the Spirit would have given him an unction. The Spirit would have said something for him to say. And that's the thing, sometimes we make one step, and God makes the next. I'm going to end with this evening and then you can ask your questions. Many, many years ago, well, not that many years ago, while I was in Kingston, I was in prayer. Some of you have heard me tell this story before. I was in prayer And the Spirit of God said, pick yourself up and go to the transport center in Halfway Tree. There was a new building that was built for the school kids and anybody, all of the buses coming from outside of Kingston and some of the rural areas and Kingston communities, they would come into this structure in the Halfway Tree area, and then they change, you know, transfer to other buses and so on, to the transport center.
And the Spirit of God says, go to the transport center and I want you to pray. So he didn't tell me what I wanted to pray, what he wanted me to pray about. He just said, go to the transport center and I want you to pray. And so I sat there and I thought about it. And I said, I don't take the bus. I have never walked to the transport center. I don't want to be in the transport center. God, I don't think you're talking with me. So I ignored it. I absolutely ignored it. 2 weeks later, a young girl she was 9, I think, 9 or 10, was kidnapped in the transport center. She was sexually assaulted. Her throat was slashed. And they deposited her body just up the street from where I live. You want to tell me that God wasn't speaking to me and I was disobedient? I'm going to tell you this. That's what I'm saying. I'm not a perfect person. So I can't blame that gentleman, because we all make those mistakes. We all miss it sometimes, and then people die because we don't listen. People die. And the Lord said it to me. He says, you were disobedient and that child died because you did not. And he went on. How do you think I felt? How do you think I still feel? I regret not following through on what the Lord says. After that, I went up there and I walked around and I prayed. But that was a bit too late for that young lady. So now, even over here, the Lord has instructed me to do certain things that seem strange. People have seen me walking the streets of Port Maria at 5 a.m. in the morning and wondering, what the heck is that man with this kind of... And the Lord tells me exactly how to dress. He tells me exactly what to put on. He tells me where to go, how to walk, what to say. And I'm walking at 5 a.m. in the mornings. I'm walking the streets by the courthouse, by the parish council, this area, that area. And I'm declaring the word of God over the community. I've done the same thing in Galena. One person, I remember, saw me one day outside doing something like that. And me and they laughed me to scorn. I said, well, you can laugh. I know what God is doing, and I know God is probably even protecting you. Amen. I'll continue with our teaching tomorrow. I hope you have a little bit of an insight in the word of wisdom. And I hope you have a little bit of an insight in the ability of the church of the Lord Jesus Christ. We are too dead. We need to come alive. We need to awaken. We need to quit praying for revival and let revival begin in us. We need to walk into revival. Stop praying for revival and revive yourself. Get into the word. Get into prayer. Do something. Begin to fast. If you can't fast for 10 days, fast for 1 hour, fast for half a day. Do whatever it is that's within the scope of your ability to do. You don't have to. You're not comparing yourself to anybody. You're not trying to do something with anybody. Your benchmark is Jesus Christ, not Pastor Watts. You know, your comparison is Jesus Christ, you know, not Patricia Harper. And we need to awaken. We sit around and we sit in dead churches with dead ministers, dead members. I hesitate to say this, but I'm going to anyway. The walking dead. I've said to people, and they've looked at me strangely when I've said this, I says, if you want to stay where you are,
The dead shall bury the dead.
The dead shall bury the dead. But there are a group of people, and there are several people like in the community here in Port Maria, there are groups of individuals in various denominations and so on. They are life to God. And they bring life to their church. And they bring life to each other. And that's wonderful. So they're not just living in this dead world. They are giving life to each other and energizing each other. But then there are others that just dead. Don't get me wrong, they pray. Many times they fast. But the Bible says,
why do you fast and then don't do the things that I say you ought to do? Do you have any questions this evening? Or any observations? You're all very quiet. My God. It's a very sober night, isn't it? Or sobering night. Praise you, Lord Jesus. Praise you, Lord Jesus. Praise you, Lord Jesus. I want to thank you, remember to pray for Sister Downer, Sister Dazzling Downer, and her family, just lost her brother. And, anyone else that, you pray for each other. You see them here, pray for each other. You see, it is important. The Bible says, you see the people that are on the screen in front of you. The Bible makes a statement. The Lord said this to me many years ago when I was in my teens, actually. I was reading a book. And while I was reading the book, this statement jumped out at me, and he said, you become intimate, that is spiritually intimate, with whom you pray. So if you and I get together and we study the Bible and we pray, we are intimate with each other. So something can be going on with Patricia in London, and Patricia in London is so far away, but because she's intimate with me in the spirit, I know that some, and I want, Patricia, what's going on? And many times, some of you, I will send a text to you and say something, and you wonder, how did Pastor know that? And the person will respond, Pastor, I needed that. Because we are intimate in the spirit. But we become intimate with each other because we gather together. That's why the Bible says, come together. It's an intimacy, not an intimate. You see, we assume it's because of natural intimacy. No, it's because of the supernatural, spiritual side of intimacy that we come and we begin to exercise. And then the next part of it that this author said was that we become intimate with the one to whom we pray. So we are laterally intimate and we are vertically intimate. The book of Ephesians, in the first few verses, talks to that issue and talks to the power of the believer with intimacy with God vertically and intimacy with the body in which we exist. Amen? But let's wake up. Let the gifts of the Spirit begin to manifest. Let's stop walking around as dead, docile, too quiet Christians that are doing nothing but complaining and chatting and gossiping and backstabbing and doing all manner of things and have absolutely no power in the earth. The Church of the Lord Jesus Christ did not enter a social program climate. It entered a powerful teach, preach, heal, and signs and wonders follow. People were astounded when Philip began to speak in Samaria, and not because he carried a government program down there to feed the homeless. It's because he carried the power of God. He cleansed the lepers. He healed the sick. He cast out demons, and the people were astounded.
thousands came to know Jesus Christ. What are we doing? Well, it seems that you're all really thinking tonight. I pray God's grace upon you. I pray God's peace upon you. I pray that there truly is a sense of greater power, greater anointing that is apparent to each one of you in the atmosphere of your lives. That Christianity becomes more than a word or a title or a name, but Christianity truly becomes a spiritual lifestyle. A lifestyle of power, a lifestyle that changes things, a lifestyle, you know, I sit or I lie on my bed or I have a couch in my bedroom, I sit in the couch or I lie on the bed. And sometimes people will think, well, maybe he's not this or he's doing this or whatever. And sometimes I'll have, you know, the Honeymooners on or, you know, Lucy or one of those things might be on or Hogan's Heroes. I mean, I like to. Some of them old black and white stuff. I don't like my mind wandering into stuff I don't need to wander into. But then all of a sudden, the Spirit of God begins to speak to me. And usually he begins it when I get up and I start to walk on the outside, I go down the back, or I start to walk around the corner into the bathroom, he begins to speak to me. And if he can speak to me, he can speak to you. You and God, you're not in any kind of malice. Come on now. He doesn't want to malice you. He wants to talk to you. He wants to strengthen you. He wants to empower you. He wants to put his arm around you. He wants you to walk in a tremendous sense of his grace, a tremendous sense of his ability, no matter what anybody says. And that is the challenge. We have too many Christians making fun, putting down, and talking about other Christians. Let it alone and begin to talk to God about you. Amen. God bless you. Have a wonderful night, and we shall see you next week Tuesday. Remember Sunday? Hopefully we will have power. May God may be having some challenges here with electricity. And it's not somebody asking me, well, why don't I get a generator? I have two generators. It just takes too much effort to go put the generator on. Then by the time you put the generator on, the light comes back. And, as a matter of fact, I need to go service the generator. But we do have generators. It just takes too much effort. And there's nobody usually here that early in the morning to help to put them up or turn them on and connect them to the house. And so that's why we don't, you know, use one. But again, may God bless you. Have a wonderful evening. Sunday, 11 a.m., we continue with our message from last time. And I do have something that I've been trying to start, but I haven't yet. I was about to get up this morning and talk about the church and the dead church and what we think about dead God and all of that. But thank God I didn't get on because I was really too lit up. This is Patricia. I was so lit up this morning and kind of angry with the devil and angry with some attitudes that I hear and see out there, you know, and so thank God for his grace. I literally went and pulled cinder box and scraped gravel and dirt in the back and got myself so tired. I mean, my back was hurting a little bit, not bad, but, you know, the muscles. My arms were hurting a little bit, the muscles, my legs were hurting a little bit, but I needed it because it calmed me down. Amen. Have a wonderful night. We'll see you next time. Amen.
Thanks, Pastor and Brethren. Yes.
Good night, everybody.
Good night.
Good night. Was somebody wanting to say something?
No, we're just saying good night.
We're just saying good night.
Okay, all right. Wonderful. Good night, everyone.
Good night, Pastor Watson. Good night, everyone.
Good night. Good night. It reminds me of the Waltons. I don't know if any of you have ever seen The Walk.
Yes.
Good night, John Boy. Have a good one. Bless you.